think as a result of that, there was one piece in there, and I recall we discussed it here, that had to do with the geometric shape.
Mm-hmm.
And because that no longer is included in that section, that's why we're having the difficulty with these longer lots, long narrow lots. It makes it more difficult to include that here because they can't get the ratio to work.
Okay.
Essentially it. So we might have to take another look at that.
Yeah. Add that to the,
mm-hmm.
the list we have.
The parking lot, yes.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Yep.
Okay. Yes. Virginia.
Virginia Adams, a member of the Historical Commission. I'd just like to mention that there was a historic property on that house, and the applicant has gone through demolition delay and has been very cooperative, and unlike some developers, and I'd just like to put a plug in for him.
We don't hear that a lot.
Anybody else have any comments or questions? All right. So Dave's not here, and he usually makes our motions.
Second.
All those in favor? All right. So we've got how many copies of these do we have to move?
I think there's two. And there should be a new pen. It should be easy as anything. We don't have heat, we don't have, but we have pens. So we can send you with one tonight, we keep one?
Yes.
Yeah.
These are the 19th.
There's two for you. You have to sign both. Did these come with rubber bands?
Yeah, I think so.
Did I lose them?
Next up on our agenda is Certificate of Appropriateness and Administrative Approval of Minor Site Plan Review for 12 Woburn Street, Timbuck. You're here for representing?
I'm representing Pam.
Perfect, excellent. All right, anything you want to
take us off? So this is currently, it's been a yoga studio for many years, and so what I did, basically all they want to do is paint and put up a new wall sign and a blade sign. and put a new door. So rather than drag them through site plan review, I thought it would be helpful to the applicant to try and discuss it here, and then if the board agrees, do what's sort of a combination of a certificate of appropriateness and administrative approval for minor site plan review. It's a little tricky because this never, all of the, I looked back as far as I could, and I couldn't find a site plan review for this building. There must have been something at some point, but the file didn't reflect, this would have gone back like probably to the 70s. So maybe it was pre-site plan review, but when this was the yoga studio before Corbear, it was a, it got a waiver for site plan review. So I'm basically amending that waiver to bring this before the board tonight as a administrative action, which is not exactly a dirt straight line, but hopefully it gets us to where we need to be to just understand that there's some minor changes here. It's not impacting anything. It's going from one retail use, a yoga studio, to another retail use, an art studio, and seems not to warrant any kind of major review. So that's what I was proposing. No, it's still there, but it's coming down.
So the canopy's coming down? Yeah. Do you want to just give us a brief overview of the changes you're proposing?
Yeah, so currently there's a black awning up there that runs pretty much the length of the store up on top, and that blue color is there. That's going to come down. And it already is, so it looks like it's covered up on the top. There's already a spot behind the current awning, which is just a flat area, which looks like a sign probably was at one point. So we're going to fix it to that spot, where, you know, not going on fiber. And then the blade sign, so the sign, the big sign, is going to be made out of wood. I brought a sample of the letter with metal letters affixed to it. That's a B. So that they'll be affixed to it. Using appropriate wood screws, non-rusting, or wooden stain, drip down. And then the blade sign is going to be also made of wood, but it won't have the metal letters, it'll just be painted on to the wood. And I think there's a copy or a picture of the bracket in the back as well, for the blade sign. Yeah. The blade sign would be 30 inches. So we go 4 inches to the right and left of those hooks there. Wide. Drop them down. And then those colors, the colors on the picture as well, I think I was discussing with Pam last night, it's a general representation. I always say that because she doesn't actually have the name of the color yet to give you, but it wouldn't change much from that. That's the best she could do on her software. But the only thing that may change is the door, and if it changed at all color-wise, it would be less bold. It would be something a little more traditional. But I think that's about as good as she'll go for the door.
Any questions from the board on this?
Yeah, actually, that's a good point. It does, I think that's just how it's shown, but there is an 8-foot marker there, and we're aware that it has to be 8 feet.
Okay.
And so this is what, Gene, this is what it's going to document the change? Or is there an actual diagram?
There is a decision.
There is? Okay. Will I pass it? Oh, yeah, that's right.
I can add the condition that the blade sign needs 8 feet clearance.
Okay.
Good, good. Any other, any questions, concerns? This one, Nick, is the one?
Yeah, we'll sign that. What came in our package?
Okay.
And no light?
No. All right. So they, so are we going to approve this as a minor modification?
Yes.
And then?
It's a kind of a twofer, a certificate of appropriateness and administrative. You're going to either approve me to approve it or is it just bless it?
Well, that's the way it's written, so we should just go with that. Plus on the checks.
The latter, that we just approve it?
But, no, the decision is already written throughout the town finance.
Oh, yeah, okay. So let's just do that.
More or less through the board to the town planner, saying it's okay.
Yeah.
So I move that the board approve the administrative, move that the board recommend the town planner administratively approve the minor modifications of facade and signage as presented for 12 Wilton Street.
Well, the administrative approval of the facade, but the certificate of appropriateness for the sign. I think I squished them into one. I'm probably confusing that a little. But you might want to take two separate votes.
Okay.
Or one that says we're doing a certificate of appropriateness and recommending the town planner administratively approve it.
Okay.
Does that sound good?
Yep.
So I move that the board authorize town planner to administratively approve minor modifications of the facade and that the board approve the certificate of appropriateness for 12 Wilton Street.
Second.
All those in favor? Got it?
Got it. Thanks.
Thanks.
You're good?
Thanks.
Thank you very much. Thanks.
Good luck.
Thanks.
Do you have the stamp?
For, please. We could do it later.
Should be in the back.
Thanks, Nick. All right. All right, so next up on the agenda, signer modification request for 50 Walker's Brook Drive Fuddruckers. Hi there. Gene, I know there's been a little bit of activity around this the last couple of days. You want to just bring us up to speed?
Sure. So you might recall that back in June, the signage was approved. And so since then, there's been a little bit of a discussion about whether or not there maybe wants to be some changes. So this is what, it's up the right way. this is what the board approved last June, which showed, pretty small, but it basically says that Fuddruckers is internally illuminated, but you might remember there was some discussion about concern about spillage, and so the board voted to have remove the goosenecks and just have the banner that says Fuddruckers. So Fuddruckers is internally illuminated. So when the applicant came to the counter last week, they had expressed some interest in having additional illumination. And that's when I suggested I think it needed to come back to the board because this approval just showed the actual Fuddruckers illuminating with everything else not. So now what's before you is a revised plan shows that all of the letters would have the light shining through, opaque background, internally illuminated, and the lettering Fuddruckers on the banner, and then World's Greatest Hamburgers would all, you know, be illuminated so that the lighting would be shining. And that's kind of what it looks like at night.
So the only change is World's Greatest Hamburgers, which is not currently lit, will be lit. Anything Gene missed or anything you want to add to? Okay. What questions do we have from the board?
There will be some diffusion on the acrylic itself will be diffused, and if you look on sheet 1B on the projection, the LEDs are on the down two more right here, down there. The LEDs are on the facing the inside, and so there will be a passage of the light back to the back of the sign and then back through before it actually shine. So it's not, there won't be any hot spots of LEDs. There'll be some diffusion there, so.
Wait, which way are the lights? They're facing out, right? You're saying they're facing back.
The LEDs themselves are actually aiming back towards the sign, but then it's reflected back out through the
acrylic
letters, yeah.
Okay, so they sort of, you're avoiding the holes of the letters with the light.
Exactly.
Kind of around.
Yeah, they wrap around. Yeah, there's no hot spots from the LEDs themselves. So. I can provide that little information for you first thing this morning.
Yeah. Just wondering if that's going to wash out some. It's probably going to wash out some of the greatest part of it, right? So it's the same in all of them, all four words, if you look the same way?
Again.
There's probably a lot more light on the building whenever it is it'll be coming from.
Yeah.
Do you, is that a concern or no?
No, well,
that is what it is.
Yeah. Yeah, right. But as far as the sign goes, seems like.
That's interesting. I want to see what it ends up looking like.
Yeah.
I think there'll be more light. The Fun Records part is going to have a diffuse light behind it that's on the circle. Right? The back is flashing back. So the Fuddruckers is lit because there are lights pointing at the building that then come through the white hood.
There actually will be a solid back to the Fuddruckers banner, so the light won't actually hit the building.
No, no, no. But the Fuddruckers ribbon is in front of the disc, the right. World's greatest disc.
Right.
And so there are lights between the disc and the ribbon, and those lights are pointing at the disc. So at the very top of the Fuddruckers line, and at the very bottom of the curved Fuddruckers line, you'll have some light that's going to light up your disc because it's pointing towards it. So it won't be as crisp as it. Unless you're building some kind of a frame around it.
Yeah, I think that's a question. Is it?
Right.
Is there something?
No, so I think that was our first solution, and then that was when we came to get the permit, thought we should change. So this is our new proposal based on that. We took that out, so there isn't any light now coming between the banners and the water pump. We eliminated that based on Gene's comments. So I think they were. You know, when we came back for the permit, it seemed like the concern was when you get up close, you're going to see a band of light shining in somebody's eyes. So we took it out. And then we need the world's greatest hamburgers to be that lit because there isn't anything else lighting it anymore. So
Okay. This
is our solution. We like it. We think it'll work. And everybody seems happier with us. And we'll be good with it.
Okay. That makes sense. Good.
When we were at the counter, whatever day, Monday, you were talking about illuminating all these letters, which wasn't what was approved. It was just the banner. So that's
right,
why.
Right, so now we'd like it to be approved.
Now you're asking
yeah.
for all of it to
right.
be
illuminated.
Yeah.
That's what we'd like.
So. Is there anything in our packets as far as the decision goes?
Yes.
Okay. I'm sorry, I didn't get to go online.
It's basically.
Oh, yeah, okay.
I don't know if it's in there, maybe it's not, but there's a memo.
Mm-hmm.
It's before all of it.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah.
Okay.
You gonna stay on a roll, Nick?
What's that?
I said, are you gonna stay on a roll?
Yeah,
you want to get comments? Sure, yeah. Anybody have any comments on these proposed changes? No? We got Tony.
Move that the CPDC authorize administrative approval of minor sign change at Fuddruckers. No, I have it on this.
50 Walker's Brook Drive.
50 Walker's Brook Drive.
Anybody have a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
So, in favor,
yes. Yep.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you.
You mind putting that down? So now Are we moving to Anthony's now, Jean? Or do you want to do that after?
Hold on, go.
Oh, I'm sorry.
One question before we go.
Sure.
So does Dylan need to come back to you tomorrow to get the physical permit, or how does it work for now?
I'll touch base with Dylan in the morning.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
Great.
Thanks again.
All right.
Oh, thank you.
We were thinking if we stayed on the Walker's Brook thing, we could talk about Anthony's.
Let's do that.
Okay.
All right.
So, again, sort of a last minute thing came in from the developer for Anthony's Coal-Fired Pizza. And as you know, they're doing their demolition work, and they ran into some difficulties. Kelly Burke is here from the Wilder Group, that is the property management firm. But the long and the short of it is they would like to deviate slightly from the old elevation drawing showing the archway and just go with the straight line drawing. And Kelly can fill you in on the rationale for why they're asking for approval on that.
Thanks for getting us on the agenda tonight. I appreciate it. This all came up as part of our construction. We started construction about 3-4 weeks ago, actually, sometime in September. And we were just beginning the exterior demolition. Because in our original approval and in our proposal, we're going to be reconfiguring the parapet, new cornices. All that stays the same. What we're talking about is the arch feature, which is a remnant of the former mackerel. Building was built in 2004 by the tenant, wasn't built by the landlord. So when we exposed the finishes on this tower feature and along the side wall, it was all the substrate was completely deteriorated. They didn't use external grade plywood. It has to completely be rebuilt. Now the tower feature is still gonna stay. What we're talking about changing is this arch feature, glazing, storefront systems, all the same. We would just be infilling, essentially here, replicating the design on both the front of the tower feature and the side. I apologize, we don't have the side elevation, but again, it's the same mirror image as this on the side. Again, the stone stays the same, eliminating that arch feature. The difficulty here is this is deteriorated, this is a thin brick. It's impossible to find a similar type thin brick. So some of it has to be replaced if we would keep that feature. And again, the whole reason for keeping that arch in place was really for ease of construction. Frankly, Anthony's and the landlord wasn't too thrilled with it. It screams mackerel. They wanted to really try to blend better with the rest of the design in the center. So from a tenant standpoint, this is a preferred concept. We apologize for the late notice. Again, all of this came out as a result of the significant deterioration, which means we have to replace all the sheathing in that feature as it is. So we felt like it was the right opportunity to see if the board would consider that. And time, obviously, with the construction season so short, fast approaching the time of year when it becomes difficult. Anthony's is hoping to get open by the end of this year. And we're actually constructing, the landlord is actually constructing the exterior facade work for the tenant. Do you have any questions?
So I also note on here that the door on the Chipotle rendering is in a different location. Is that intentional?
I didn't even notice
all
that.
Right.
I'd have to look to see what was approved. I wasn't intending on bringing that before the board. I apologize. I have to look at what the original elevation was, but by no means were we intending on.
Yeah,
the change. Although this is based on what is being built. So, I didn't realize it'd been a shift in the door location. I don't recall that. I've been dealing with the tenant, Chipotle, in this case, and I don't recall them shifting that door.
The outdoor seating area is tied to the curb cut.
Right. Right.
Yes.
Right.
So that's an important detail.
That's what I was thinking, is that you shift that door and there's actually a site plan repercussion.
You're right.
So I have the floor plan, and this shows it off-center. Chipotle is centered, is off-centered in this location. This is a construction drawing, so the rendering is just wrong. I think they were trying to put the rendering, so this is the definitive location, and it's per the original.
So I also noticed that in the old elevation to the right, I don't know if that's an overhang for the outdoor seating in the bar area. Is that going to be eliminated?
Yeah, this was that was the original canopy from Mac Grill.
Oh, it's the original
one.
Which
was going to stay intact. The patio elevation, side elevation will not change at all. They'll have their awning, the fans, the lighting as per the original program. Nothing changes beyond that tower feature. Signs are all the same.
The only awkward thing is that you've lost the mass of the corner, sort of, your blank wall. Not that I like the arch, but and the storefront in that area is lower than all the others. You might be better off painting that white area around the storefront for anything that's the same color as the dark thing.
This area here?
Yeah, see that? If you painted that all the dark color, then at least you have the appearance of a bigger room.
A little bit of a okay.
It's kind of tiny.
Did you reposition the sign? Is that pushed down a little bit?
It's pushed down a slight bit just to break up the
expanse. Yeah, no, that makes sense.
It is slightly slower. It's the same sign design,
sure.
Just was shifted.
Yeah.
I don't know, maybe there could be some, just a suggestion, some scoring on the ephes.
So what we have to look forward to is the rest of the lilac behind all of that ephes.
Yeah, we're replacing all of that, actually. The front, everything on this side was fine for whatever reason, because there was a canopy there. We took that canopy down. The whole side is going to be replaced.
Did they even have the newer drainable?
They did not.
They did.
And it looks like particle board.
I just say, let's just word the decision, or whatever we call it. Are we going to do this administratively, or is it
fine? That's okay.
Just word it so that it's the Anthony's corner that we're approving based on the submission, since there are some irregularities in the board.
Yeah. Although, do we want to add, from the way you have it written, also the, I don't know what you call that, the what you pointed out, the overhang?
Yeah.
It's not only the archway, but it's the overhang over, I don't know what's there on that side, like a side entry, yeah.
The storefront setback. There's actually one
on the front, yeah.
Front and side?
Yeah.
Okay. Any other, oh, I'm sorry, what was that?
Anything else?
Not here, I think.
I think that's good.
Covers it.
Second? I'll second that.
All those in favor? Thank you, yes. All right. So that takes us through all of the projects, right? So now we can move to planning updates and other topics, and I'm guessing we've got a few people here for the criterion topic, so why don't we jump to that and kind of walk through that piece, and then we can jump to the other items.
Sure. You want me to start?
Yeah, if you wouldn't mind, that'd be great.
So we wanted to have it on the agenda tonight, just to really limit the conversation to procedure. This is per my conversation today with town council. He would very much ask the board to not deliberate on the topic tonight, especially some of the things that have been discussed at the HDC. He will come back at a future meeting, and we can have a more detailed conversation about the substance of what's being dealt with at the Historic District Commission. But I think given the fact that there was a meeting last week, and I know there's a lot of interest in the project, they've been before this board for site plan review, limited site plan review per the Dover Amendment, it seemed like something that we ought to stay on top of. And so I would just say that there are two meetings scheduled, one for this Thursday and one for the following Thursday, for the Historic District Commission to continue to review what's been submitted. Nothing has been submitted for CPDC, so the site plan review decision that was voted on all those months ago is what stands currently from CPDC. I would anticipate that they, once they are through the Historic District Commission process, that their next step would be CPDC. So the timing and when this all transpires, I'm really not sure about. I'm not sure anybody is. But we have to be especially careful because there is a potential that this could end up in litigation. So we want to make sure we're on the straight and narrow with town council in the room.
Sure. Okay. Do you guys have any questions or?
Can I ask questions?
I know, right?
That's. I went to the second half of that meeting last week. I dumped the book, so I kind of forgot.
Thank you.
That's all my
okay.
Time, right?
I want to certainly give you an opportunity to ask any questions you might have of us. I realize we're. Please, Virginia.
I just wanted to point out that when Criterion came before you previously, that was on a different plan, and we are now considering a second reiteration. But they are using what they've told us is that they're using the same parking plan and driveway plan, and that's what has become an issue for the district commission, that we're focusing on that. And so if and when you rehear that, bear in mind that the historical district commission was not in place at the time when you heard it first, and you were under the constraints of the Dover Amendment, and still will be, but as we are. But you'll have to broaden your horizons maybe a little bit when you consider it. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Everett Blodgett, Historic District Commission. As Jim just said, we have a whole new application setting in front of us. And we kind of questioned that from the beginning. CPDC would probably have to be involved at some particular point, but they were operating on the plan that was there before the historic district was there. What was interesting is at the meeting last week on the, I believe the 14th, about 100 people there, and there was a lot of intense and good questioning and fairly good control from the meeting, which was very nice. But there's a lot of stuff that came up that isn't in our jurisdiction. And so those topics, which I'm just running them by, not to make decisions on them tonight, but to know that we can't control them. The situation of dirt, what's brought in, what goes out, we don't deal with that. We do with grade level, but we don't deal with dirt itself. So there's an issue there. There was a lot of discussion about drainage. About 2 to 3, 4 years ago, I believe in April, we had a lot of rain. Park Tavern, Park Middle School lot, recently having the Collins turf all going down. A lot of that isn't as permeable, and there was a lot of runoff problems, especially down Temple Street, stuff like that. The project not adding to the problem is a concern to us, but we can't do very much about it. So drainage is a big problem. The width of the driveway, the visibility of the historic building that will be there has a setting issue. The setting, they're going to restore a beautiful building, and then cars and stuff to look over to see it presents a problem to the historic district. And so anything that can be done with the width of the driveway, the amount of cattle, the parking, because we both hold that in our purview, in our responsibility. Then sewage was also mentioned. I'm not sure the utility stress on Woburn Street, where that drainage goes, it's not under our jurisdiction, but we don't know how that all works. I do know that there have been backups on Prescott Street at times on the high amounts of rain, so I assume Woburn Street might be the same way, if that's where that water would go. You start to put in a bigger facility there, there might be issues. And signage might crop up. It's under our purview, but it's also under your purview, a little bit jurisdiction. Looking forward, I had asked Jesse before, not knowing that she was leaving, and then got the information she was leaving, I felt that down the road, certainly not now or under criterion stress, that I think the two boards ought to look at some issues and develop a best practices for historic districts. I'm planting a seed now, I know I'm planting a seed, but I think down the road, if you knew more about what a historic district, you'd have a better handle on this when it started. This application didn't start under a historic district. We presented it altogether different. We aren't aware of that, but I want to get things more under control for the future, as we have quite a few buildings now. We're 67 on West Street and 26 on Summer Ave that are in historic districts now. And one might project that there might be more later, so it'd be a better thing to solve problems now, not later. I guess that's about it. Thank you, board, for considering and all the hard work that you do. And we are working at it. It's, but we're in a little bit of a gun too, because November 6th is the farthest they'll extend out for us.
Yeah. What are the days? When are the meetings again? And what's your deadline to make a decision?
October 22nd, which is this Thursday. Right now we're scheduled for here, but the possibility of having a lot of people that were trying to move up to Coolidge and see if we can use the room up there again. And then on October 29th. Actually, we'll be trying to iron out problems this 22nd and get some agreement on things so that the people and the lawyers can start some writing so that we can have the 29th to basically approve what's written and be done by the 6th. That's the projected plan for that right now. Did that answer your question?
Yeah, it did. Thank you. So the 6th is the deadline?
Yes, they've extended for us. Obviously, it's been out about a year. So they've extended for us several times because of a public hearing and not being able to get a place and vacations in the summer.
Yeah.
It got pushed back, so now November 6th looks like our...
They're not going to extend.
They're not going to extend again.
Okay.
And again, the Dover Amendment applies to us too, so it's an issue that we're very much aware of.
Okay. Great.
Other
Thank
questions?
You.
All right. Did I cover the bases this time? Anybody's toes hurt? Okay. All issues. There's still some issues out there, but the big one is the parking and the driveway. The driveway being 24 feet wide, and then when you add 15 feet for parking spaces on the side, that becomes a huge piece of macadam compared to what there is there now. Mm-hmm. And I think West Street, some of the lanes are 10 and a half feet. I seem to remember somebody saying, well, we had to go down to 10 and a half feet to get the bike lane in. It isn't really a full bike lane, but they're using 10 and a half feet for one direction, and this has 12 feet for one direction. I think when the fire department, and I'm just giving myself information, seeing if I've got any memory banks left at all after these weeks, the passage up at the library was, the fire department needed 20 feet for the truck, because there was a lot of talk about taking so much of the lawn up there. Well, here they got 24 feet. It's just a huge piece of the car. I would guess it's 2 to 3 times bigger just for the front driveway. So I don't know where we can draw that line, and that's what we're going to be talking about.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Any other comments? Give George a chance.
Is it their comments?
I'm sorry?
Is it there for the public?
Yeah, we can.
Yeah, I have a question and a comment. I think the comment first, the 24-foot width is required for heading parking to be able to maneuver to do a 3-point turn to get out. This is typical for parking garages or parking areas. You basically cannot negotiate heading parking at 20 feet or 21. You will be overhanging. My question is whether there will be a new site plan review with a new footprint of the building on the site.
There is no new building on the site. The historic building, with its what they refer to as its non-historic addition, what's happening is they're going down in the ground with extension down into the cellar to the basement, and the barn is going to be another extension down into the basement. So there is no footprint planned in either one of the buildings. Including the addition. There will be the tunnel that goes from the non-historic addition, which I really think is historic. Something 60 years old is getting pretty historic, I guess, about.
The existing.
Yeah, the existing. And the existing barn. So there'll be a tunnel underground. Again, if it's truly underground, the HDC has no jurisdiction over it.
So right now, George, I mean, We approved a plan a while back. I don't recall exactly when it was. They've put forth a new plan that has not come before us yet. We assume it will once they get through HDC, but they haven't submitted anything yet for CPDC to look at.
I would point out the criterion has been very, very good at adapting for our concerns. We're just to the real sticky ones, that's all. And it's a case of not knowing what requirements, what you can take out that front end parking and put it someplace else. Mm-hmm. Parking out toward the front and on the side of the building just becomes very, very difficult for us to look at.
Yeah. Virginia?
Fortunately, through this process, both historic structures are going to be extant and standing, and all repairs and restoration will be in products of like kind. So we're quite comfortable with that. And now we're addressing the setting for the historic structures. And that's where the driveway and the parking area and snow storage and all those items starts coming into focus for us. And although we don't do landscaping per se, we'd encourage other boards to put in
something, conditions that would promote a good setting for the historic structures and for the neighborhood. We have to consider the whole district.
Yep, that makes sense.
Again, we do control some on parking and some on some of the issues, but it depends on how our ground level. If they decide to fill for 3 feet, is it the old ground level or is it the new ground level? And it becomes a problem for us because we haven't worked under those parameters at this particular point.
Okay. Well, thank you for that feedback. That's certainly helpful.
So, Gene, it sounds like there's obviously been a lot of public comment and participation. Is there a way, I don't remember, I'll put it this way, I don't remember us getting meeting minutes or sort of wrapping in public input in other projects that have come before us that there's been a lot of public discussion on. Maybe it's because we've typically been first and then Conservation Commission, or I'm not sure why that is, but it seems like, that it would be a good thing if we had, I don't know, I assume that meeting minutes are being kept and sort of issue, how different issues maybe came up and got resolved, would probably be helpful for when it comes back to us for everyone, so it's not like everyone's rehashing the old issues. If we, especially if we have something that we're asking about in terms of making site plan changes that have already been addressed and someone from the Historic Commission isn't here, what have you. So, just from a process standpoint,
yeah,
making sure that we have the full picture when it does come to us.
All right. Good.
I will.
More to come on that for sure.
Thank you.
I'll hand it back to you.
Thanks, folks.
You're more than welcome. Thank you.
All right. Let's take a look at the meeting calendar.
Right, so I have 2016, and I was also going to maybe open it up for the rest of 2015. Right now we have what's left for the calendar year is two meetings in November, the 2nd and the 23rd, and two meetings in December, the 7th and the 21st, which is like 2 days before Christmas Eve. We typically don't meet more than once in December, so I will just put that out there. If there is a way to consolidate and put out one meeting a month, that would be a lot easier for staff, since like basically I'm it.
That's what we say, staff, we say.
The staff has come to me and they've expressed a concern. But we can also, you know, the staff is flexible, so.
So the 23rd is the Monday before Thanksgiving, right?
Yes. Right now, we have a DRT Wednesday on 258 Main, which is the old Valerie's Bridal. So I would think that would be, once we have a DRT, that would be queued up for a site plan review or a modification. It might just have to be a whole new site plan review because it's been 2.5 years, totally different design. Probably start all over again with that. And then Lyle Estates, which is the 40B that is off of Lowell Street with all the wetlands and sort of going towards the Wilmington line. They have circled back with basically using the existing house and adding two houses up to make a total of a 3-lot subdivision. So those are the only things in the queue. If it makes sense to go with a meeting in late November, like the 23rd, in case those projects, give them enough time to get advertised, because there won't be enough time. We're scheduled to meet 2 weeks from tonight. That won't give enough time for those projects. Rather than convene everyone for an hour or two meeting, you know, an hour and a half meeting. It might make more sense to just wait till the 23rd. I mean, unless something comes in that I don't know about, you know, tomorrow, that say, oh, no, we've got to meet on November 2nd. But we could just go with the 23rd and then again with December 7th. That administratively would make things a bit easier, but again, if something comes in and we have to keep the calendar, keep the November 2nd, I might just suggest that as a maybe for right now.
Sure. Yeah, right now you're not anticipating anything being ready for the 2nd?
No.
Yeah, I'd be fine with that.
But it could change. Like, I mean, Thursday I had two things coming.
Yeah, sure.
Thursday, so that could change real fast.
But we just got to figure out at what point can we say, all right, we're canceling the 2nd. Would it be the week before? Which would be, I guess, a week from today?
I would say if I don't see anything between now and Thursday, you know, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, nothing comes in. I mean, we start putting packets together
right. The
Monday and Tuesday, so.
So let's do that. If by Thursday we don't have anything, just make the call.
And I can work with Jeff if everybody's okay with that.
And then for December, I mean, does it make sense to just do one meeting but change the date to like the 14th? I just pulled the number out of the air. I don't even know if I can do that, but.
We've always met early in December just because December calendars get so crazy with everybody. All their commitments in December.
So let's just keep to 7th.
And then we'll meet again in the early January, so.
Mm-hmm.
People are doing projects in December. It's
sort of par for the course.
Yeah.
People know.
No one's getting in the ground anyway, so.
That's true, yeah. Okay, so we'll TBD on the 2nd.
Yep.
We'll decide by the end of the week.
Yep.
We'll keep the 23rd, we'll keep the 7th, and we'll cancel the 21st.
Sounds good.
Cool. And then next year, I mean, looks fine to me.
And in terms of doing anything for zoning at next subsequent town meeting in 2016, we have to have everything done really early in January. So.
Wait, the November next?
The warrant has to close. I'm sorry, for annual town meeting. We're not going to do anything for zoning on annual town meeting. That's closing early. Usually we close the warrant in February, like February 24th. This year it has to close in January.
Okay.
Because they have to get everything organized and ready to go well in advance for some reason. I can't remember why. But we're about a month ahead for annual town meeting. But we weren't going to plan to have anything ready.
Right.
But certainly, we can certainly start in January talking zoning again, especially some of these parking lot issues. Start hammering through that if we don't have any real big projects or cases or whatever.
When do you think that the time is right to start dealing with the sign bylaw?
It's interesting you ask
because
that question.
Because I wonder if, you know, if there's some that are contentious or some applicants that don't agree with what we have to say, whether they want to go the legal route.
Yeah.
So are we just sort of sitting ducks here?
Town Council and I talked briefly about that today. I'm waiting for him to get back to me with some further guidance on that. So we definitely need to put that on the radar screen so that we're ahead of the curve.
Because our sign bylaw is full of issues.
and the PUD and the PRD that we've been talking about, and you know, starting to think about that as the next piece. I'm going to meet with staff tomorrow to work on kind of where we're at now with the rest of what was on our to-do list for the zoning bylaw. There's a link on the website that we had used in the past that needs to be updated, and Caitlin and Mariana and I are going to put our heads together and figure out, just so it's clear if anybody went to this place, the spot on the website to say, okay, what have we done? What's before town meeting this November? What's, you know, the future? Mm-hmm. We kind of had that nice graphic, Jeff, that you talked about last year. That was really clear on kind of where we're at. But, you know, we've got some preliminary work on those other areas as well, and certainly the cleanup, that there's no really no point in waiting much longer to
yeah.
tackle some of that.
Yeah.
January.
Yeah. We'll probably want to put some time on our first meeting just to start prioritizing what we want to focus in on. Or I guess reprioritize potentially, because we were pretty clear on where we were going.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
Good. Anything else on the calendar? All right. We've got next up associate membership replacement. Sad topic. So, George, I know you indicated in your last meeting your intent to resign as associate member.
Yes, I'm here today to see when would that be a good time for you folks. Starting from tomorrow, I believe the end of my term in the summer. I definitely want to make room for the younger generation to step in. And now that you are five members, the, you know, having an associate member as a backup in the case there is no quorum, I don't think that is much of an issue with a five-member board, which was a discussion we've had about 2 years ago, 3 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So there, as far as, you know, my intentions are really open with you, if any type of wrap-up in the PRP, PUD, or any other effort that I've started needs to be wrapped up under a flag of associate, maybe I can do that over the next, by Christmas or by beginning of Christmas, and then send also a resignation letter. That is like a bit easier. If not, I mean, I could still remain intact. I'm not leaving town, and I can still do that and open the door like tomorrow. I just don't have all the parameters. I have no real horse into this. I feel strong to open the door for someone else to step in. So I wanted to discuss this with you, to discuss the timing. If you have needs, or if you have other concerns, or how this is. Maybe you have nothing, but better ask now.
Yeah. I mean, you were pretty, you were really helping us through that PRD and PUD discussion, and you produced some really good documentation. We had to put that aside for a little while, given Jesse's departure. But I think that was the last big thing that you were working on, and from my perspective, I don't think there's anything left that you need to do as relates to that.
I think where I left it was some type of reconciliation between those two, and having options as a homeowner or a small developer or a larger developer, have the options to plug in and basically meter the intensity or the specificity of approvals, of permit and approvals. But I think we stopped it because the, a more holistic view is a better approach. I think that may require probably a consultant to make it simpler and smaller and smaller. So you are correct. I mean, my input would stop very close to where I am right now in terms of trying to fine-tune and comb through the irregularities and basically infuse a little bit of flexibility. But if you look at the wholesale, I have no idea how, you know, how you would start by writing zoning from zero. That would be the idea. Or maybe take a model from another town and begin to change it. And I'm not sure that would be appropriate either, because our community is very unique, mm-hmm. as we heard before. We have many non-conformances that we know, and actually you know, NZBA knows. So that non-conformance aspect is very big in that PRB and BD. So it's complicated.
And Gene, do we need to be careful about changing associate membership before the change to, before town meeting and before the AG approves that change to the...
Yeah, right now, technically, under zoning, CPDC is a 5-member board. We've had associate members, but now with this new change, it's basically codifying that. Once the AG gives us the green light that now we've codified it correctly, then would be the time to embrace what's going on with the associate member. And it always takes time to find people. It's, you know, it's awkward because we can't start the process without like an email or something saying I'm resigning, but then it takes time to find someone. So there's a little bit of a lag in there. This is probably not a big deal because technically under the bylaw, we don't have associate members, so not to say that you have been a huge contributor, because you have, but I think it's probably a lot of semantics.
If there's a vacancy, that some people may see vacancy, and we need to discuss it with friends and others, that, hey, you go look, there's a vacancy. I mean, we could ourselves discover others, like we've done for years, to discover interested parties that are going to come out because there is a vacancy. So, you know, just for planning purposes, let's, if there was like a month or a month and a half or 2 months before that date, whenever that date is, I think that would be like a reasonable.
Yeah.
I would think that it would be odd. I mean, sort of odd if I was going to be brought into a board where the rules of my engagement of what I can do and what I should be doing are about to change, or you know. So it's probably probably not a good time to even start making that change until, right. There's always that big lag time between it being approved and then the AG,
yep.
And it just sort of seems premature to be making changes.
Yeah, and it's really, town meeting votes it in November, hopefully, and then the town clerk has to get it into the state, so that's always a couple weeks, so call that December, then they have 90 days. Then we have to post it for another month, so it's really, it's almost 6 months.
We'll keep in touch.
4 months anyway.
Yeah. But as far as, you know, work projects, I think we're whole. We're good.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
Thank you. Yeah.
One hiccup is I won't be in the distribution list, but I will still try to somehow connect with you.
You probably will. Charlie Adams still is. Yeah. Yeah, look at the emails, or you may, I don't know if you, emails that I get still has Charlie listed.
There's nothing stopping us from giving it
sending them to George, right?
Well, you can also sign up for the agendas on the website.
Yeah, that's fine.
Which is what a lot of people do, you know, stay interested.
I'll be an easy customer, I promise.
Thanks, George.
Thank you.
All right. I know we've got minutes here, but Jean, any other updates you want to provide?
You might have noticed that the new lights are up on the MF Charles building. Those were the gooseneck lamps that were approved way, way, way back. They're similar to the ones that are in the outdoor patio. So those just went up over the last few days. Likewise, there's another Trailblazer sign that went up to replace the one that a snowplow crashed into in front of McDonald's, pointing out down towards One General Way. So that's a new sign.
Didn't take out the play structure?
No. I asked my inspectors about what's going on with Perfectos. Conservation is up there a lot, making sure that the riverbank and such are intact. It's just a really slow process. The building inspectors try to get out there. They're there some days and not there others, so it's tricky. They're just slowly, slowly, slowly doing their thing.
Did I see a for sale sign on the site that was approved for Pizza World?
Yes, we did. I don't know what that means. Last time we were in discussion, the applicant had a concern about the plan that we had conditioned in the decision that if there ever were something discovered during construction, contaminated soil or unanticipated site condition, that there would be a plan of action to follow, and that's pretty much a standard requirement. We had it for Perfectos, and it was a good thing that we did have it for Perfectos because they did hit things in that soil. And conservation they asked for the same thing. But when the time came to address that before the building permit, the applicant had some concerns.
He has concerns with implementing the plan.
Yes.
Right, the cost of implementing the plan.
The cost of having the licensed site professional draw up the plan, even. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So
is that expensive?
Well, it all adds up. I mean, remember we were talking with him about the cost of vertical granite curb versus something else. So I think the budget there can't take a whole lot of.
Yeah.
An LSP costs a couple of grand. And if something happens.
That's the big thing. But I don't think it was a heavy demand from a project management point of view. I think it was a good thing to be mindful of. Like I say, they ran into problems at Perfectos. And they hadn't had that action plan in place. The contractor maybe would have remove the soils instead of just leaving it there. The LSP said, if you find something, this is on Perfectos, it wasn't anything major, but if you find, you know, something, don't disturb it, just leave it. So if that's what the LSP has said in the action plan, everybody knows what the plan is. A contractor might say, oh, we gotta dispose of it or do something. It's really for everybody's protection to have a game plan.
Yeah, because in the end, if their contractor disposes of it and someone, let's say, finds out that they disposed of it, then it comes back to the owner, and they end up in having a bigger problem than if they just, you know, dealt with it according to the LSP. So it's
these are tricky
really
sites.
Perfection. I mean, it's protection for the owner.
Yeah. We know because we hear these stories. A contractor might think he's doing the right thing and just do the wrong thing, and now you're a bigger mess.
Okay. Anything else out there?
That's it.
Post office?
This rumbles, but that's about it.
Walgreens?
Nothing on Walgreens. Nope.
And nothing on that 40B at Doucette's?
Nope. Nothing on the 40B at Doucette's. Nope.
All right.
Did you notice the lighting at Fusilli's restaurant there? They strung a whole bunch of Christmas lights in the trees, which I think are street trees. I think they're ours, right? They're red, white, and green lights, so they're not really for Christmas. I thought they were town streets. I don't know if they're all put in there. And the worst part is they're just sort of thrown in there. It's not even organized. It's like, it's really tacky, crappy. So if they're not supposed to be in there, let's get them out of there.
I can make a call to them.
I'll just go cut them out.
He'll do it.
That's the gateway. You know, I mean, Cal's had to go through a whole bunch of stuff to keep their place all clean and neat. This guy should have to do the same thing.
Anything else? All right. I'm going to knock out these minutes and we'll wrap up. Thanks, George. Thanks, Tony.
Good night.
Could bring up a topic.
Yeah.
The signs at what is that? Gulf? Is that a Gulf station now?
Shell station.
At the very south end of Main Street. Used to be Mobile and Dunkin' Donuts, and then it was corner of Main and South Street.
611.
Is that what it's now?
Yeah.
That has LED signs. Did we see them? Did they?
You mean the pump toppers?
No, they both in there, in the the freestanding sign is LED, and pump toppers LEDs. I don't ever remember seeing any of those, but maybe I wasn't here. I don't know. Also, the pump toppers, it flashes back and forth between member price and cash price or something like that. Yeah. So the numbers don't change, but the sign along the top changes fairly frequently. I mean, probably once every 8 to 10 seconds.
But they're not all, that's the one I always said is the example, because they're not all flashing at the same 8 seconds, and so this
right.
one goes and this one, so
right.
you're getting a bunch of them. They went to ZBA and got a variance, that's why you didn't see it. I was at that meeting, they wanted
to
put
straight
signs
to ZBA.
On the canopy, they wanted everything. We did not, and they did not talk about this flashing element when they asked for the pump toppers. So they agreed to just paint the canopy, put on the pump toppers, and then change the freestanding sign. And that's what ZBA approved. And then I drove up to the top of Main, and there they were flashing
yeah.
their message. They used to change both the price and the member price and non-member price. So that's where I counted it up. It's like 38 characters max on 6 pumps, double-sided, and they're not flashing at the same time.
I remember you talking about that. I thought you were talking about the TVs that are on the Shell station down the street that come on when you pull up, and there's TVs, you know, the little little screens that come up and tell you the weather and stuff.
No,
that are
the mobile has those too.
Yeah.
No, I wasn't even talking about those.
I thought that's what you
Yeah, I guess you could consider that off-premises advertising, because they do show advertisements for things that are not offered there. You get a little news, a little weather, and then some ad.
I think they all have them. I think Cumberland's has them too.
Yeah. And you know, the mobile on the corner of Summer and Main, they shut down pretty well at night when they're supposed to be off. Pretty much every light is off. And they have a freestanding sign that's not tremendously huge.
Right,
lately.
Yeah.
Those LED toppers are coming. That's why I keep asking about the flash. They just haven't resolved it entirely now.
We can send someone out to look at that. 611.
Send them for Silly. Keep going.
Yeah, Biltmore hadn't changed their lighting yet. They had their lights off. The outside lights off when I drove by last, but they hadn't fixed the blade sign.
Yeah.
I saw Cumberland Farms, they finally completed their project. Remember how they bought that building? We're going to tear it down.
Yeah.
I just caught it out of the corner of my eye. It looked pretty good.
Sure.
At least it seemed like it was recently completed. I hadn't noticed it. Is that recent?
Mm. Probably the end of the summer. Yeah. I'd say August.
Yeah, I just noticed it yesterday.
It looks neat and clean.
Yeah.
Tidy.
Everybody good on the minutes? Anybody have any? Do we all get through them?
No, I did mention to Gene that the recorded decision for Criterion has the wrong vote. It was noted as 301 in the records, but it should be 310.
That's correct.
That fits.
CPDC approved the minutes for October 5th, 2015.
Yeah, that's right.
Second.
All those in favor?
Connor's Dave.
Oh yes, that's right. Yep. That's right.
Three.
301.
301.
One more?
Move that the CPDC adjourn.
Yeah.
Second.
All those in favor? Thank you.